The Lord be with you. Welcome to worship. Thanks so much for joining with us today. We are happy to have special music all throughout the service today. Special music performances are with us. Pastor Allyne prays with us. And we worship as always in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God who forgives all our sin, whose mercy endures forever. Amen. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us now confess our sin in the presence of God and one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sin. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sin in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Now let us pray. O God, we thank you for your Son, who chose the path of suffering for the sake of the world. Humble us by his example, point us to the path of obedience, and give us strength to follow your commands. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. It's children's time. That means all you grown-ups, scoot back a little bit. Make some room. And all you kids, gather in real close. Come hear the good news. Now, our gospel lesson for today is really part of the same one that we read last week. Last week, we read part one, and this one is kind of the second part of that same story. Do you remember the one that we read last Sunday? It was about one of Jesus' disciples named Peter, and it was during the time when Jesus knew that the people in charge were getting really uncomfortable with how he shared the message of God's love, not just with the richest and the most powerful and the most important people in the world, but more so and even especially to the people who were the poorest and the ones who weren't taken care of or weren't cared for by anybody. Jesus said God's love is for them and for everybody. And what happened during that time is Jesus knew that his time to be upon the cross was coming, and so he asked his disciples, he asked Peter, "Who do you say that I am?" And this is the important part of the gospel. Peter said, "Well, you are the Son of God. You are the Son of the living God." And Jesus was so happy that Peter, there was finally somebody who really understood who he was. And Jesus said, that's the confession, that's the testimony, that's the proclamation that the whole church is going to be built on. I'm going to build my whole church upon that statement, Peter, that you are the Son of the living God. And what happens in today's story is the next thing that Peter says. Because once Jesus tells him that I'm going to build my whole church on this statement, then he tells his disciples what's going to come. He tells him that he's going to have to undergo suffering for the sake of the world so that he can save the whole world. In order to save the whole world, he knows that suffering is going to be a part of it because the world is going to reject him, but he refuses to reject the world. And he tells Peter that I'm going to have to go to the cross and die. And then Peter does the one thing that we should never do. He says, Lord, this can never happen to you. God forbid this ever happens to you. I will never let this happen to you. Now, do you see the mistake he made? He said that Jesus is the Son of God, and then the Son of God told him what needed to happen, and then Peter disagreed with him. He said, no, that's not going to happen. That's terrible. Something better than that has to happen. Now, the truth for us is that Jesus promises that he's going to save the whole world. But even though the world might not always accept him or be happy to receive him, he will always be happy to receive each and every one of us. And that means go into the places where there is pain or where there is sadness, and that we ought to go there too. Because when we go, we bring the message of Jesus with us to those places. That's very important. It's very, very important for discipleship. That's how they know that we are disciples. Would you pray with me? Dear God, we thank you for giving us your Son, and we thank you for inviting us to be disciples. Help us to always follow the commands that he gives, the instructions that he gives, and the promises that he gives. And that in those times when it's hard to trust and hard to believe, Lord, never let us go. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Our gospel lesson this week really needs to be understood in the context of our gospel from last week in order that we gain the whole picture. Because it's really sort of a whiplash for Peter. He's that strongest disciple upon which the entire church is built. He's lifted up as sort of the role model for us all. But with one swift mistake, he's seen in an entirely different light, which really puts in perspective what it is that Jesus came to do, what it is to love our God and to love our neighbor as ourself. That not only is he my own Lord, but he's also the Lord of all, and we all need saving, and he doesn't need any saving from us. The gospel according to Matthew, the 13th chapter. When Jesus came to the district of Caesarea and Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say that the Son of Man is?" And they replied, "Well, some say John the Baptist, others Elijah, and still others Jeremiah, the prophet." And he said to them, "Okay, so who do you say that I am?" Simon Peter answered him, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." And Jesus answered him, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father in heaven. And I tell you, you are Peter, you are Petra, you are the rock which I will build upon my church upon, and the gates of Hades will not prevail against it. I give you the keys to the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven." And then he sternly ordered the disciples not to tell anyone that he was the Messiah. And today we find out why. Because they're not ready to fully grasp what that means. So from that time on, Jesus began to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and undergo great suffering at the hands of the elders and the chief priests and the scribes, and be killed, and on the third day be raised. But Peter took him aside, and he began to rebuke Jesus, saying, "God forbid it, Lord. This must never happen to you." And then the Lord turned to Peter and said, "Get behind me, Satan. You are a stumbling block to me, for you are setting your mind not on divine things, but only on human things." And Jesus told his disciples, "If any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake, they'll find it. For what will it profit a person if they gain the whole world, but forfeit their own life? Or what will they give in return for their own life? The Son of Man is to come with his angels in the glory of his Father, and then he will repay everyone for what he has done. And truly I tell you, there are some standing here who will not taste death before they see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom." This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. And let us pray. Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. I bet you wish Peter wishes he could have that one back. You have moments like that? I've got a few. Two or three. Maybe four. Tops. Lots. Lots of moments like that that I wish I could have back. And the problem for Peter was that he refused to see the Lord as the Lord of all. And what he wanted was to protect him. And I don't doubt that that came from a place of love for the Lord. But I think it's also very true to say that a Jesus who would be protected and sheltered from any harm or pain in this world would bode well for a disciple Peter, who would have been sheltered and protected in this world. You know what I mean? If the Lord is going to suffer, I think Peter sees that, well, he's going to suffer to do. And I wonder if he wishes he could have that one back. Now, I wonder if he actually wishes he could have the whole proclamation back, right, where Jesus says, "You are the rock on which I will build my church." Because I think times had to have been probably simpler for him before all that went down. You ever done that? Wish you could kind of go back to when times were less complicated, less fraught, less charged, less painful. One of the things that my family loves to do, and we've done this almost every summer, dating back, I think, to 2004, at least, is we go to the Back to the 50s car show at the fairgrounds in St. Paul, and it's this huge car show. It's cars that are 1964 or older, so it's a lot of really old cars, beautiful cars, and everybody parks there, and we sit in our lawn chairs, and we visit, and the radio's out there, and they're playing, I can't think of, what is it, doo-wop music, 50s music, 60s music, that good old music, and it is such a good time to reconnect and get back to when times were simpler or more comfortable, or at least in our memories, simpler or more comfortable. And when Peter tells Jesus that this suffering that he's explained is going to happen, when Peter tells Jesus, "There's no way I'm going to let that happen," I think what Peter is probably trying to do is take Jesus and say, "We're going to keep things simple and easy and comfortable. There's no reason to complicate what we've got going here by you suffering. Let's just keep you protected." But when Peter said that, that didn't take Jesus, you know, back to the 50s, so to speak. What it did was take him back to the wilderness. Do you remember what happened to Jesus in the wilderness? I think that was Matthew chapter 4, where Jesus was tempted by Satan in the wilderness. And Satan, in so many ways, said, "Compromise who you are, compromise what you're about, and things will be easy. Things will be comfortable. Things will be great." And I've got to imagine, because of how parallel the stories of the temptation with Satan and the story of the temptation with Peter are, when you look at those two stories side by side, the language and the tone and the rhythm of the temptation of the wilderness in the wilderness by Satan and the temptation by Peter, they look just the same. What Satan learned, and really what Peter learned, and I hope what we all have learned, is that Jesus isn't here for easy. Jesus is here for you. And his mission was that no matter in what ways he's rejected in this world, he would never reject God, and he would never reject you. And what that meant for him was that he loved us all the way to the cross and through the cross and beyond the cross. Now, he can't blame Peter for having the kind of reaction that he did when Jesus told him about the cross. Barclay says, I like the way he put it, he says that no one wants a cross. No one wants to die in agony. Even in the Garden of Gethsemane, on the very last night of his life, that same temptation comes to Jesus. Temptation is always there, always lurking, always around the corner, always tempting. The temptation to take another way, an easier way. And here Peter is offering it to him now. So the sharpness and the poignancy and the sorrow of Jesus' answer to Peter's interjection, it's due to the fact that Peter was urging upon him the very things which the tempter was always whispering to him, the very things against which he had to steel himself. Peter was confronting Jesus with that way of escape from the cross, which to the very end beckoned to him. Escape from the cross, I think, sounds like a good thing. But it wasn't the thing. And it's difficult because Peter, who was the tempter in this case, he didn't say it out of malice the way that Satan did. He said it out of love. He said it out of love. But love in this sense, I think it can be dangerous. We all know what it means to love somebody even though they are in pain. But there's no amount of love that can take another person's pain away. It can only help share in it. It can only help share in it. And I was struck when we were reading the confession and forgiveness at the beginning of worship, like we do every week. And it's every week that same confession. I have not loved you with my whole heart, and I have not loved my neighbor as myself. If Jesus would have taken that easy way out, there would have been no redemption. Right, because if we were to save him from death, that no death would mean no cross, and no cross would mean no resurrection, and no resurrection would mean no redemption for any one of us. And so to love Jesus the way that he asked us to and invites us to is to allow him to be not only the Lord of my life, but the Lord of your life as well, and the Lord of those whose lives that we love, and those whose lives that we don't know, and those whose lives that we even hate. Sacrificial love, it means sharing. It means recognizing that God would never leave a single one of us behind. It means resisting that temptation to try to get a little bit larger piece of the pie for ourselves. That's what temptation is, and that's what the word Satan means, right? He's a tempter. Barclay goes on. He says that that Satan is any influence which seeks to make us turn back from the hard way that God has set before us. Any power who seeks to make human desires take the place of the divine imperative. The divine imperative is God's will. What God says must be done. And Jesus tells us explicitly in the gospel today that the Son of Man must undergo suffering and death and the cross. What made the temptation here more acute and severe was the fact that it came from the one who loved him. It's dangerous. Peter spoke as he did only because he loved Jesus so much that he could not bear to think of Jesus treading that dreadful path and dying that awful death, the hardest temptation of all is the temptation which comes from protecting love. There are times when fond love seeks to deflect us from the perils of the path that we have to walk, but real love is not the love which holds the knight at home. This guy Barclay, he's about 100 years ago, and he's Scottish, and he talks a lot about knights. I kind of love that, but that's the example he gives us. The real love is not the love which holds the knight at home when he should go out to battle, but the love which sends him out to obey the commandments of the chivalry which is given, not to make life easy, but to make life great. It's quite possible for love to be so protecting that it seeks to protect those that it loves from the adventure of the life in Christ and from the strenuousness of the path of the pilgrimage of God. That which really wounded Jesus' heart and that which made him speak as he did speak was because the tempter spoke to him that day through the fond but mistaken love of Peter's heart. And that's the same temptation that continues to be a real, present, gripping danger for each and every one of us. Jesus says that in order for us to love him, to really love him, means to deny ourselves and to pick up our cross and to follow him. And I think that that's, a dangerous path to walk down. I do want to say that not all suffering is good, and that not all suffering is what God intended. But what I want to point out is that there are times when we see the people whom we love wading into dangerous waters, and sometimes we see them doing it for the sake of somebody who's out there and who's stuck. That's the kind of love that Jesus is talking about. To go out and save somebody from being Christ for somebody else, well, that doesn't redeem anything. It's there that we have to be brave. It's there that we have to trust. And Christ says, if we're going to truly be his followers, it's there that we have to go too. There's two things that I know in this world is that suffering happens, and that Christ is always there. And for those of us who've recognized that, there is no going back. There is no going back to the simpler times. There is no avoiding the temptation of wanting to go back to those simpler times. All there is Christ, who's promised to lead the way, promised to never abandon us, who's promised to never abandon anybody. Thanks be to God. Amen.
You will hear my voice. Although we may not understand how we can do this, we pray with the confidence of faith that God hears our every prayer. Oh, and even though you're probably sitting on the couch or in an easy chair, your response of "hear our prayer" at the end of each petition could be somewhat loud, kind of un-Lutheran, especially in your living room, but give it a try. Let us pray. Gracious God, you have called us to a life of discipleship, and we pray that you give us the courage and the strength to live that life. Teach us to serve you through service to others. Help us reach out beyond ourselves and to touch others with your love. Lord, in your mercy, God of wonder, in your glory you created the earth and all that is on us. Give us the eyes to see the world as you see it, and then give us the wisdom and the courage to love it and tend it as you would. Lord, in your mercy, God of all nations, you call us to live in peace. And yet we argue and fight and make war. Forgive us, Lord, and help us to look at others for who they are, your children, as beloved to you as we each are. As both the Democratic and the Republican conventions are now done, be with all who are running for president, filling them with love and kindness for their opponents. Lord, in your mercy, God of comforting presence, we always cling to your promises, but especially when we are scared or grieving or sick or filled with despair. We pray especially for all whom we name before you in our hearts and for all who have no one to name them. Lord, in your mercy, God of all faithfulness, you have called the people of our Saviors to follow your Son, Jesus Christ. Grant us trust in you that we will lose our lives for the sake of Christ and thereby discover joy in life through him. Lord, in your mercy, in the certain hope that nothing can separate us from your love, we offer these prayers to you through Jesus Christ our Lord. And all God's people called out, Amen.
We take now a few moments to focus our hearts and minds in offering to God what he has first given us, ourselves, our time, and our possessions. Your commitment to this congregation is what allows us to be generous to others through our ministries. We invite you to support the ministry we do by writing a check and dropping it in the mail, or by clicking the donate button on our website, or by downloading and utilizing the Give Plus app on your smartphone or tablet. Our Savior's Lutheran Church is very grateful for your generous offerings. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. My friends, receive now the blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine upon you with grace and mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Now, go in peace, serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.